Let us stand as we continue. Remembering our baptism, remembering God's promise to be present as we gather in His name, we continue in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear people of God, our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. And we read in Psalm 130, If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. Gracious Lord, we give thanks that you have given us faith by which we are able to give witness and celebrate your Easter victory. We confess that too often we have remained silent when confronted with the possibility of physical harm, social stunning, and even unkind remarks from our neighbors. Forgive us and strengthen us for witness. Likewise, we give thanks for the joy and hope your resurrection provides. We confess that too often in our daily living, we have let the conflict, turmoil, and immorality of the world cloud that joy with sorrow and gloom. Forgive us and strengthen us for witness. We give thanks for the fellowship of believers that we enjoy here in this place and wherever we gather around your word. We confess that we have not always demonstrated the peace and forgiveness you brought to the disciples on Easter evening. Forgive us and strengthen us for witness. It is my joy to declare to you that Almighty God has given His Son to die for you, and by raising Him to life again has declared that the payment for your sins has been accepted. He has given you His Holy Spirit that you may trust Him for all things and serve Him with joy. As a called and ordained servant of our Lord Jesus Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
We pray. Almighty God, on Easter evening, your Son sent his disciples out with the resurrection news of repentance and forgiveness of sins. Strengthen us by your Holy Spirit, that we may be consistent and courageous witnesses to his resurrection within our society and among our family and friends. All through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated as we continue to hear God's word.
The first reading for today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 5, verses 29 to 42. But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill him. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men. For before these days, Theudas rose up claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God." So they took his advice, and when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching Jesus, the Christ. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading for this morning is from 1 Peter chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith through a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes through its test, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In honor of our Lord Jesus, let us stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Dear people of God, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Congregation may be seated, and this time would invite the children of the congregation to come forward. All right. Thanks for coming up. I'm just real quick, real curious here right now. How many of you have a grandma that's still living? Okay, about all of you do, I think, okay. Now, I'm just curious, any of you have a grandma that has a farm? Do you? Okay, and still that lives on the farm? And okay, doesn't live, used to, okay. Well, when she used to live on the farm, or maybe she still does, did they have animals out on that farm, okay? Did some of them maybe even have ducks on that farm? Did they? Okay, all right. Well, then that story is going to work for you. Others, you're just going to have to kind of imagine this, okay? But this is the story of one young boy. He was about maybe your age here, okay, about your age here, and an older sister, all right? And we're going to call the younger boy, we'll call him Billy, and the older sister, Sally. Well, they're out playing, and you know, as we're getting a little older and stuff, you know, that old throwing arm gets a little stronger. And how many of you ever gotten in trouble for throwing something in the house? Okay. I know what that feels like. But we get thrown a little bit better, so they're outside and they're out playing and stuff. And there was Grandma's duck, and in fact, even her favorite duck there and everything else. And he's throwing some rocks and things. He's not supposed to, but he's doing that. What do you think happened? He hit one of the ducks. In fact, grandma's pet duck. And it killed the duck. Oh, and he doesn't know what to do. And he kind of takes it out. Kind of, there's some trees kind of behind the garage. It's terrible. And he just, now what should he have done? He should have told Grandma. First, shouldn't have thrown the rock, but now should tell Grandma. But he doesn't. There's only one other little problem, though. His sister saw what happened. So that night, they're having supper and everything else, because they were staying with Grandma right now, and they're having supper, and after supper, Grandma says to Sally, the older sister, "Hey, you know, I'd really like you to help me with the dishes here and picking up and everything else." And Sally's sitting right next to Billy, and she said, "No, I think Billy wants to help clean up all the dishes and pick up everything. Don't you, Billy?" And then she kind of leaned over and said, "Remember the duck." And so what do you think Billy did? He helped dishes. And said, yeah. This went on for the next 2 days. Every time Grandma asked Sally, "Oh, I think Billy wants to do it. Remember the duck." And finally, Billy couldn't take it anymore. And what do you think he did? He told Grandma. "Grandma, I'm just so sorry. I was doing something I shouldn't have been doing. And your pet duck is dead. And I'm so sorry." And this is what Grandma said. "I know. I happened to be watching out the kitchen window when that happened. And I've been wondering how long you would let your older sister, you know, rule your life like she's done for the last 2 days. Of course, I forgive you." But we're kind of like that. God's Word talks about that, how we cover up, we don't want to admit our sin. And the psalmist talks about in Psalm 32 and Psalm 51, and in places like this, he talks about how it's like it's just eating us up on the inside. And then finally the psalmist says, "But when I confess my sins to the Lord, then you forgave my iniquity, you forgave my sins, and the burden was lifted." How long could Billy have been living with that burden and not telling Grandma what had really happened? It could have been forever. And that could have been, Because every once in a while, Grandma might have been saying, I wonder whatever happened to, you know, I wonder if a hawk got it or something. And he'd be sitting there, oh, Grandma. And then when he finally confesses, she already knew about it, didn't she? God says, confess our sins to him and know that he will forgive us. Let's pray, okay? Let's bow our heads, let's fold our hands, and I invite everybody to join in repeating after me. Dear Jesus,
we thank you
for your love,
for the forgiveness of our sins.
Help us always to trust in you and to never be afraid of admitting our sins and turning to you for forgiveness. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming up and helping me out, guys. Thanks so much. We continue with our next hymn. I think that was the short version of our hymn. And either that or I missed a couple verses when I was trying to get my microphone fixed, and I apologize for that. Dear people of God in Christ Jesus, I read again from the closing verses of John 20. Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And then John explains to us a little bit about what happened and why he wrote this gospel. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. May the Lord bless our hearing and meditation upon his word. Last Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, was the culmination of just an awesome Holy Week. We had Palm Sunday and the confirmation services and Maundy Thursday services and the stripping of the altar and things. And there were different things we did in all of those things, and Good Friday services and some different things we did, and then the celebration of Resurrection Sunday. And at different times, you know, some folks would say, oh, Pastor Meyer, I really like this. Or, you know, like one example, I really like that confirmation service, how you did this. And I said, well, you got to talk with Pastor LaRue about that. He kind of put, you know, some of that together in the way. And I really liked that. I had done something similar to churches that I had been at. And, you know, a lot of different people contributed. Well, Pastor, I really like that crashing of the cymbal and stuff. Well, you got to talk with Candace about that. She's the one who brought the cymbal. And we kind of figured out where to put that in. And it seemed to work really well. But the point is, a lot of different people working together, sharing their different ideas, is what made it all work. And in anything good that came out of all of that, to God be the praise and glory. Because He's the one who gives us the gifts, the abilities. And if we listen to one another and respect one another, you put that all together and boy, God can be glorified and God can sure do some awesome things among His people. In our Bible readings, our sermons, our cottage group meetings, in our private conversations, we've been hearing and sharing God's Word, telling us we must talk with one another as we work out differences or desire to be reconciled, reminding us that as God's people, we must love and forgive one another. It's just kind of part of the job description of who we are and what we do as God's people. But we've known the families, we've even known congregations that sometimes really struggle with this. And over the years, I've been a pastor, what is it now, 36 years? 37, whatever it is. 36 years, coming up in a month. But at different times, I've had to talk about this. And I remember one time, one congregation, you know, somebody coming up to me complaining about something, oh, Pastor, and it's this and this, and then they just stopped. They just stopped right in their tracks. I hadn't even said a thing yet. And they said, I know, I'm supposed to go talk to him first. And yeah, okay, and that's what they did. I don't know that I've ever been in a congregation where we kind of talked about this a little bit, where I've seen and have heard, especially in this last week, people coming to me and telling me that they had acted on this. They've talked with others with whom they had maybe had a little friction. Maybe the other person didn't even know it, but said, hey, I need to talk with you. And they talked, and words like this were shared. I'm sorry, and I forgive you. And maybe there was even a hug of reconciliation. I heard this from several different directions, and I will tell you, folks, it brought tears to my eyes and a joy to my heart. When we hear of people, and I heard this at least 3-4 different times, and it was like a weight lifted off my shoulder. Well, you see, that's how it works. Little Billy that I was talking about in the children's message there, you think he had a little bit of a weight on his shoulder? He had killed Grandma's duck, his pet duck. And his older sister's making his life miserable. Well, Satan loves to do that with us. Just make our life miserable. Here's a few other things, and here's a few other things, and here's a few other things, and I'm never going to forgive them unless they come crawling to me on their knees, and the person comes crawling to them on their knees, and they go, they weren't sincere. And they still don't forgive them. And Satan kind of sitting there in our ears and serves them right. And I just wonder if sometimes the Lord just sits back and weeps for us. Just as He wept over the children of Israel that time when He looked at them and because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Struggling in whatever the troubles and trials and fears and hopelessness, whatever it was. God has said to us, it doesn't have to be that way. He has assured us in Christ, there is forgiveness offered to all. This is the announcement to the disciples by Jesus on that first Easter evening. Whosoever sins you forgive, they are forgiven. We call it the office of the keys. This is given to the church, to God's people. When people are repentant of their sins, you can announce to them as though Jesus Himself were right there, your sins are forgiven. But if someone is saying, you don't know what you're talking about, I don't need any of this, Jesus, I'm doing fine, just this way am, and they're not repentant of their sins. They're not even recognizing a struggle for their sins. And whosoever sins you retain, whosoever sins you do not forgive, in announcing the law of God's word, those sins are not yet forgiven because they continue in their sin, they continue in their rebellion. But what a joy and privilege it is for us to be able to share with fellow Christians in our family, husband and wife, with our children, our parents. I just had that privilege this last week talking with my folks. And not to go into all the details of it, but what a joy it was for me to repeat to my dad things that he had said to me time and time and time again. And now it's time for his son to share it with the father. Dad, just like you always said, just keep trusting in Jesus. Keep turning it over to Jesus. It'll be okay. It'll be okay. That's what we have the privilege of doing and sharing with one another. That's what God has given to the church. Now, do we face obstacles and challenges and opportunities as God's people? Yes, we do. But what a joy of knowing we can do so with burdens removed, walking in the love and grace and forgiveness of our Lord and Savior, and saying, Lord, where you lead, we're going to follow. But yeah, there's challenges facing us. We live in a troubled and spiritually dark world. What exactly should we do as we go forward? I know I don't have all the answers. If you're all sitting there, if this congregation is sitting there saying, well, I sure hope Pastor Meyer comes up with those answers pretty quick. What a sorry lot you are. But God does have the answers. And we will know and He will reveal those answers as we keep turning to His Word, as we keep receiving His Holy Supper, as we keep remembering our baptism, as we respect and value unique and special gifts that God has given to one another, to realize and remember He does have a purpose and a plan for us right now and leading into the future. And oh, some of the amazingly unique and wonderful things that God has in mind for us. Some of it as simple as love one another as I have first loved you. And go make disciples. Be my witnesses. As we listen to one another, ponder God's word. As we respect one another and the ideas and the perspectives we all bring to this. God will continue to guide and lead His people forward here at Trinity according to His will and according to His purpose and plan for us. But to do this well, we got to set aside the selfish pride, all those things that hinder us, all those barriers that we've allowed for us to stumble over, our selfish pride, our hurts, the bitternesses, the fears, our apathy, the hopelessness, and instead strive to soak in all of God's love and grace that we can possibly hold, to soak in and rejoice in His forgiveness, to soak in and reflect His love, His forgiveness, His compassion for all people, beginning in our own families. Beginning among our brothers and sisters in Christ. And to make a decision as people whom God has already called into His family of grace, to make a decision that echoes the words of the writer to Proverbs, I will trust in the Lord with all of my heart and lean not in my own understanding. In all my ways, I will acknowledge Jesus as Lord, and where my God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit leads, I will follow. It's as simple and as complicated than that. And all the wonders we will see and experience as God reveals what He has in mind for ministry in this time and in this place going forward. This Sunday after Easter, we remember the beginning of the New Testament church as they celebrated God's promise of a Savior given to the Old Testament people. This is what God had promised all along, and now in Jesus they've seen. In their crucified and risen Lord, they've seen these words, these promises fulfilled. Now are these days fulfilled. And they spoke and lived and shared the new life and the forgiveness and the salvation and the hope that was theirs in Jesus. And they didn't look back wistful of times past when, oh, all, we could just sit back and relax and wait for something that's going to happen sometime in the future, but it won't happen now, so don't worry about it. We can just kind of sit back and relax and take it easy. No, now are these days fulfilled. And they looked to Jesus and they surged ahead in new life and new energy and new hope and new purpose. There was work to be done, people to reach, and they were excited to live and share the news that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And so here we are today at Trinity Lutheran, remembering the promises of God fulfilled in Christ Jesus. Remembering His promise, I will not leave you nor forsake you. My grace and strength will be sufficient for you. And remembering His word that says to us, as long as we live on this earth, He has a purpose for us and a place for us. And looking to Jesus and trusting in Him and His word, we will strive to live and fulfill that purpose for us this day and for all the tomorrows to come. We do this as ones who, as we heard today in 1 Peter 1, have been born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you. That's what we have. And this world cannot touch it. What we have in Jesus cannot be taken away as we keep our faith and trust in Jesus. Whatever the world may threaten us with, whatever the world may throw at us, trusting in Jesus, they can't touch what is already ours safely in heaven for all eternity. So we want to share that hope, that good news with others. And sometimes that sharing involves just little day-to-day things. Little acts of kindness that maybe seem insignificant to us, but which God can use in a powerful way, in a life-changing way. I mean, think about it. If all of a sudden you had the opportunity to save somebody's life, would you do that? Well, of course we would. But what if I don't know? Maybe it's just as, it could be a simple thing you need to do. Would you do that? Well, of course we would. Several years ago, I and four Lutheran high school sophomores in my charge. We're out of a Lutheran high school in Milwaukee. My son was in the choir at this time, and I was along as a chaperone. I had responsibility for these four young high school sophomores, not including my son. And we had a chance to eat in a special place. There's all these different restaurants and stuff, and what do you can get your... I don't even remember some of the London type of foods and stuff. They had all these restaurants. Everybody's going to these different groups. We'll meet at a certain place when we're all done. They picked the Burger King. Now, I was stuck with them, so Burger King, here we come. Well, we got done pretty quick, and we're out of there. And it's an area, and there was kind of a restroom, almost seemed like a Subway. It was kind of underground restroom there, and you're walking to it. And a lot of people are walking around there. It's kind of dark there. Well, we notice a guy that's laying on the ground just off the edge of the sidewalk, but his feet and legs are kind of covering about half of the sidewalk there where people are walking, and people are just walking around him. They're just walking around him. We later learned that people just assume it's just another passed out drunk. But I and the four students in my charge thought that just doesn't seem right. We wanted to do something to help. And so we flagged down, I had to go quite a ways to flag down some authorities to bring attention to this man who just maybe needed some help. Soon all of a sudden the emergency vehicle comes rushing in. We never got the exact name or details, except that I asked one of the emergency guys, you know, a little bit afterwards after they'd been working with him, so what was the deal? It was a serious diabetic coma. They had a special word for it, but he would have died without help. I asked, well, how could all these folks walk by? They just assumed it was a drunk, and so everybody just walks on by. Yeah, in other words, we helped save a man's life. I'm certain that those 50 or more folks who had walked by, maybe even more who had walked by earlier, that they would wanted to have saved a life, but they didn't see the need that was literally at their feet. So also for us. in our desires to be of help, to save somebody's life. It may not be dramatic, a dramatic opportunity like we sometimes see on TV or YouTube. No, our opportunities more likely are more subtle and everyday. Simple kindnesses, a simple word of greeting, a word of encouragement, just doing the job we've been given to do, but doing it with a smile and with patience. Doing our best to bring peace and hope and comfort to the people around us, and yes, beginning in our own families. And these can be some of the most powerful contributions to our family and community and world that we can make, starting with the simple act of kindness that sometimes can give desperately needed hope at a crucial time in a person's life. All centered around a simpler approach. How can I make a difference in even the smallest and kindest way? How can I be of help to those around me? That's the concern and the love that is being reflected by John when he writes this gospel. This is amazing news. They have seen their risen Lord. I mean, they were glad when they saw the Lord. Talk about an understatement. They were, wow. This is like, there's no words hardly to describe their feelings. No hope. Just Jesus, who they thought was going to usher in an earthly kingdom, and he said this other stuff that we never took him that seriously on, because who could, you know, how could he really mean that? He meant everything he said. He is everything he said. He is our Lord. He is our King, our Savior, our God. And their world changed. And never again do we hear them squabbling with one another about who's the greatest among them. Never do we hear them squabbling about who's going to get to sit on the Lord's right hand and left hand. It's like, no, what really matters is already ours in heaven. But as many days as the Lord grants us, we got to share this good news with everyone we can. Let all that you do be done in love, 1 Corinthians 16. 2 Corinthians 5, for the love of Christ controls, compels us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died, and he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. Our life is centered in Jesus. The things that matter are centered in Jesus. And we say, well, we got to do certain things here at Trinity because we got to bring in more people. We want to bring back some of the glory days of the old, and we got to do this, and we want to bring in a whole bunch of transfers, and we want to do this, and we want to do this so that we can be real. Whoa, stop. Why? Maybe there's a church somewhere where, you know, it's a suburban area or something like that, and folks are building homes there, and they're, you know, they had a, let's say a 200 transfers come in that year. Wow, they're doing great things. Well, wait a minute. Transfers, these are people walking with the Lord already. We rejoice that they have a place to worship, but it's just paper shuffling. I don't think the Lord just called us to shuffle a bunch of papers and to see which one gets to have the bigger stack of papers when it's all said and done. No, God's called us to go and make disciples. Wouldn't it be something if, let's say, by the end of year 2018, we would be able to say, you know what? There are 40 people who are now walking with Jesus. Some of them are even coming to worship with us here at Trinity now. But there are now 40 people now walking with Jesus who a year and a half ago didn't know Jesus, didn't trust in him, didn't believe in him. That would be something to celebrate. Am I right? So what are we waiting for? Well, we're waiting for the next resident pastor to come in, because unlike you, Pastor Meyer, he's going to have all the answers and stuff for us, and, you know, and he's going to, you know, okay? No, this has been given to us now. We got people around us right now. Maybe they don't even have a year. Some of them we know in our own neighborhoods. Some of them are in our own families. In love and care and compassion, We're going to share the good news. We are going to be just like John, who when he explains, these things I've written, there's so many other things could have written down, but these things are written. Jesus did so many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Somebody might go back to, Pastor Meyer, you know, so we do this work and stuff, and a bunch of people come to faith in Jesus, but they don't even all come to Trinity then. Some go to different churches instead and stuff. Well, we're not going to get a, you know, what kind of reward or what kind of honor are we going to get for that? We will get the reward and the honor of well done, good and faithful servant. Not from the pastor, but from our God and Savior. We're going to have the reward that is already ours in Christ, that is already kept for us in heaven, and that we can celebrate because, Lord, I have only done my simple, humble duty. Luther talks about that. All for which is my, to give thanks and praise, to serve and obey. Lord, you've already given me this, what really matters. This is what we have. This is what the disciples have, had and have. And we got to share it with everybody we can. This thing that motivated John to write the gospel, that everyone would know these things and by the power of the Holy Spirit come to faith in Jesus, may this be our motivation as we talk with one another, as we're reconciled with one another in family, as we share and reflect our love and concern for one another, maybe even as we call. And I think I was recently, you know, some of our folks who made some of these visits in our neighborhood, I forget, somebody was sharing, Lyle, I think you might have shared this story with me. I think it was a story with Pastor Tooman maybe. And just kind of somebody, you know, needing some help or whatever, and so calling in folks to make sure they got the help they needed. May this be our motivation to do these things, so that we can do everything we possibly could do to reach everyone we possibly can reach with the love and forgiveness of Jesus. May this drive our decisions, our words, our actions going forward, that you also may believe that Jesus is the Christ, that you also might be encouraged in your walk with Jesus, that you might also believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life, life in God's presence now, and life for all eternity in heaven, in Jesus' name. Amen. May that peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep and guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus to all eternity. Let us stand now and join together in the confession of our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated as our worship continues, as we gather our tithes and offerings to the glory of God. You may be seated. Christ is risen from the dead. Death has no dominion over him. Let us pray for ourselves, for the church and the world, that the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ have an impact on the lives of people everywhere, beginning right here with everyone around us. We continue in prayer. We pray for ourselves and our community that our Heavenly Father would provide us with the peace and security we need so that our leaders may govern, our children may grow in knowledge and wisdom, that our congregation may increase in faith and reach others, and we all might work together for the common good according to His will and purpose for us here at Trinity Lutheran Church and School and for all God's people throughout our great land, and that He would raise up calm and courageous people to keep order in our society and defend our nation from enemies of all kinds. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear our prayer, risen Lord, and strengthen us to witness our Easter faith. For the church around the world, especially wherever it is enduring opposition and persecution as experienced in apostolic times, that the Lord of the church would protect and guide it so that the gospel may be proclaimed, and that He would sustain all who are unjustly imprisoned, denied human dignity, or exiled from their homes. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear our prayer, risen Lord, and strengthen us to witness our Easter faith. For people in positions of power and influence in the nations of the world, that like Gamaliel, the Lord would use them to open the eyes of both leaders and citizens to the reality of God's rule over all earthly powers and kingdoms, and that He would lead them to work for justice within their lands and peace across their borders. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear our prayers, Lord, and strengthen us to witness our For all who, like the disciples on Easter evening, are dealing with fear, all who face this day in any emotional distress, all enduring chronic ills or sudden health crisis, or those who are in mourning, we think of all who are on our prayer list, those struggling with pneumonia, those struggling with cancer, those struggling with concerns that the doctors haven't even identified yet. We pray, Lord, that You would grant healing and strength according to Your holy and gracious will. We pray that the Holy Spirit would visit, relieve, strengthen, and console them in their various needs, and that our Heavenly Father would work through healthcare professionals and counselors and emergency workers to restore them to peace and joy, and that again, that God would grant them strength and healing according to His holy and gracious will. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear our prayer, risen Lord, and strengthen us to witness our Easter faith. Blessed Savior Jesus Christ, Your word is the bread of life. And we praise and thank You, Lord, that You have given us the promise that Your word will remain and Your promises are eternal. Keep us in faith that we may live in You even as You live in us. We pray, Lord, that You be with those from our congregation who are yet traveling or already present for the Luceda mission down in Mexico. We pray, Lord, that You would guide and lead and direct their work, that You would keep them safe, and at the same time, You would be working powerfully in those who see and witness and hear the message of love and care and compassion that You offer to all, and that we also seek to bring even to that part of the world. We pray, Lord, that You be with our elders and our council and our Stephen ministers and our transition task force as it is now getting put together over the next week. Lord, we pray that You be with them as they have important work that we all share in, namely determining, Lord, what is Your will for us? What are the needs around us? What is it that You would have us do in this time and in this place to make a difference by Your grace and power in the lives of a growing number of people. People who desperately need to be encouraged in their walk with You, and people who desperately need to learn of You that they can also find hope and share with us the blessings of Your promises. Lord, we pray that You be with those who serve within the armed forces. We pray, Lord, that for those who from our congregation, Craig Worley and Brad Musiak and Suzanne Baden are just a few of the names that come to mind. Keep them safe, Lord. And when their time of service is done, whether it's on a daily basis or after months away, We pray, Lord, that you would bring them safely home. Lord, we rejoice with those celebrating wedding anniversaries. We think of Paul and Darlene Munt as they celebrate their wedding anniversary. Lord, be with them and be with all the marriages and families of this congregation. Guide and bless them, Lord, that they would daily experience in their family and be able to continually reflect to the world around them your love, your grace, your forgiveness offered to all. We pray, Lord, that you be with Mr. David Kum and his family as he prepares to come serve as our principal later this summer. All these different things, Lord, we bring before you. Preserve us as your faithful witnesses now and into eternity. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. These and any other things you would have us ask, grant to us, Heavenly Father, for the sake of your Son, our risen Lord Jesus, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you, look upon you with his favor, and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace as you serve our risen Lord. Thanks be to God. And once again, dear people of God, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.